Hi, everybody. It is April 20th, Tuesday. What time is it here? 10:54. Getting ready to head off to rehearsal with the band. We had a great rehearsal yesterday. We've dialed in a bunch of songs and started working on another new one. So we've got, I think, we're going to go in the studio in May, end of May. And I think as of right now, we've got at least six new songs to record. Now, this album, all the work we're doing now probably won't be out until next year, because we're still sitting on our album, which we finished before the pandemic, which was supposed to be out in November, and it'll be out now August 27th. So it's just weird, we're, you know, kind of overlapping all these things, but you know, as it goes, the creative process doesn't stop. And we're just very fortunate that our label, Quarto Valley Records, get that plug in, Bruce Quarto's company, has been supportive and said, look, if you got the material, go in and cut it. And so we've got studio time booked. We've got the great Nico Bolas Engineering, who's been doing all of our stuff. So we're all set for that. I just also wanted to announce the next live stream. I have to go back to Tuesday. I'm sorry about juggling these dates back and forth like this. It's just, there's so much stuff going on. I just look for a clear day where the afternoon is clear to hang. And so the next one will be May 4th at 3 p.m. And then the next Skype and FaceTime one-on-ones in the clubhouse will be May 1st, Saturday, May 1st. I just contacted Aaron and told him about that. This Thursday is the Berkeley webinar about Billy Cobham. I guess the thing to do is go to the Berkeley Bass Department. They have a site on Facebook, and that's where the login is. So hopefully, my sister's going to come to it, but she doesn't do Facebook, so she was concerned. And Steve Bailey contacted her and gave her the information on how to log in. I would recite it, but it's a long login, and I'd probably, you know, confuse things more. So if you have access to Facebook, just go in there and go to the Berkeley Bass Department site, and there will be a thing about the Billy Cobham webinar. It's free to sign up for. I mean, it's not a big deal, but it's just that those are really fun because so many really interesting people come on those webinars, and it's cool, and especially this one to be doing Billy, because we'll be able to talk about Spectrum and everything, and Ron Carter's going to be on it, and you know, when you're doing those, you got John Patitucci is one of the moderators for it, and Steve Bailey kind of runs it all, and Victor Wooten. So it's a for anybody who geeks out on all that stuff, this is a lot of eye and ear candy. Yeah, I love it every time. I've done a bunch of them for Rocco Prestia and Paul Jackson, and all kinds of different things have been on there. So check it out. Let me think. I had one thing I was going to do today, and I think I'll probably do it tomorrow, because this suddenly somebody came to mind, and I thought I really just need to dedicate one of my segments to her, because she is so great. I really love that people really enjoyed Amanda Marshall. She's so good. And you know, and it's one of those things, like people have said, how come she isn't huge? You know, you just don't know in this business. And I've said this before, there's artists I've worked with where I thought, man, nobody's ever going to hear this stuff we're recording. This is just, you know, it's just not that good. And next thing you know, number one record, they're huge, they're a worldwide sensation, and other things where you walk out of the studio going, that's probably the best thing I've ever worked on. And it doesn't even get released, it gets shelved for some reason. So Amanda's great, and I'm glad I got that up. But today I'm going to take a time today. I was going to play along today, but there was a magic that happened in the studio when we worked together that I think is not something I would want to replicate. It would be one of those things that would be cool if the whole band and the artist was doing it together. Then it would take on this whole new guise and personality. But to sit here and try to jump back into that emotion and stuff, this is when I really am happy being an audience and just appreciating it. And for me, I really appreciate, like when I'm listening back with you guys, I'm appreciating all the musicianship, all of the writing on these projects, the production and all that. But for me, I have that other layer of the onion that I can peel back and close my eyes and be back in the studio with these people. And I can kind of, in my mind's eye, be looking around and seeing where everybody's sitting. I can feel the conversations that took place and the energy that was in the room. So today, I'm going to visit Carole King. We had a great time. I mean, Carole, I go back with to 1970 when we started with James. She was our pianist in the original James Taylor band. And we've had just a great musical and personal friendship throughout all these years. And it was such a joy. I think it was 2010 when we did the TRT tour, the Troubadour Reunion Tour. And that was putting together the original band with James Taylor, Carole King, Danny Korchmar, Russ Kunkel, and myself, and hitting the road. I mean, we had great Robbie Condor as a second keyboard player on it, and Andrea Zahn and Kate Markowitz and Arnold McCullough singing background on that. But the original core of the beginning of James Taylor's time was Russ, Cooch, myself, and Carole. And so when we got to do that Troubadour tour, it was something really quite special. And again, I repeat myself, but to me it always bears repeating. There's the old adage that you can't go home. You know, you drive by the house you grew up in, and man, it seems so big when you were a little kid, and you go by now and you go, wow, I don't remember it like that. Well, this could have easily been the same thing. We hadn't played together as a group with James and Carole in decades. I mean, it had been a long time. I mean, individually, little things here and there, but never putting it together and playing the songs of that period. But when we did it, the minute we walked into the rehearsal room and started playing, it was like nothing. We were just a day later than it was in the 70s. It was a remarkable experience to be together again. And I could have happily done that tour every year for the rest of my life. And the audience certainly was completely entranced by it, because really this is so much of the music of a huge swath of people's lives. So we continued working, and then I ended up doing an album and a tour with Carole called Thoroughbred. We did the album and then we hit the road. And it was a great tour, a great album. I mean, she's just one of these remarkable, remarkable artists that's just kind of, there's all these artists, and then there's Carole is just like on this other plane. So needless to say, glasses come off can only mean one thing, CM. So here we go. I'm going to just give you a bunch of information about this, and this is just barely touched, you know, the tip of the iceberg. But we cut this album in 1975 the great Lou Adler produced this, and Hank Ciccolo, who's a great engineer, engineered and milled Callis. I think Callis or Chalice. I think it's Callis. Is how he pronounced his last name. He was the second engineer assistant on this. This is a tight group on this one. It's just myself on these tracks, Russ Kunkel, Danny Korchmar, Waddy Wachtel, Ralph McDonald on percussion, and Tom Scott playing saxophone. Now, when I was in college at San Fernando Valley State College out here in L.A., when I was in the music department, Tom Scott was also in the music department, so Tom and I actually go back into the 60s together. But it's fascinating with Carole. I mean, she's been an active musician, writer, a recognized writer since 1958, when she was a staff writer in the Brill Building, which cranked out so many great songwriters. I mean, that was their job. This building, it was nothing but cubicles with songwriters in all of them. And just cranking out song after song. None of the people were artists. They were all writers. And at this point now, Carole's the most successful female writer in the second half of the 20th century, with over 118 hit songs on the charts. Between 62 and 2005, she was the most successful female writer in the United Kingdom, having 61 charted hits in there. It's just, in the 60s with Jerry Goffin, who was her husband, they had two dozen hits. I think that was it. In the 60s, she and Jerry had two dozen hits that are considered American standards now. And Tapestry was the number one album for 15 weeks and on the charts for over 6 years. I mean, that's just, there's only been a couple of albums in history that have had that kind of charting. And then it goes on, my notes continue on. She sold more than 75 million albums. She has 4 Grammys. She's in the Songwriters Hall of Fame. She's in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. She won, has the prestigious Kennedy Center Honor Awards. And she, in the Library of Congress, she was given the Gershwin Prize. I mean, this is the tip of the iceberg for Carole, and she's just remarkable. And she is like the most down-to-earth person. I mean, you'd be on the road together. And yeah, I mean, here she is. I mean, she's this, you know, she's a big deal. And she'd be coming over going, you guys want some cookies? Can I get anybody in? Yeah, I mean, it's like, she's just a unique, unique individual. And one of the more soulful human beings I've ever known. And, you know, she was always incredibly shy when we got started in terms of like getting her to go out and perform. I mean, she was confident as hell as a writer, but getting her to sit at the piano and play in front of an audience was not her thing. Where she evolved into, man, she eats a stage up when she's on it. She just loves being out there, and she does it so well. So I thought I would just do some songs today from Tapestry. And the fun part of this is I'm leaving here after doing this to go be with Russ and Cooch and Waddy. And so here we are in 1975 working together, and here we are now still going on. Still, I mean, it's amazing to me the journey that we've all had together has been quite profound. I don't think there's too many relationships in the music business that have really had the kind of enduring life expectancy that we've had, and the fact that it's ongoing. I mean, you know, we're sitting here doing new material. We have a film coming out about us, and you know, we're starting to look at, you know, getting gigs booked and hitting the road and playing for you and all that. So it's amazing to me. This is all I just every day I just get such a kind of a thrill out of what this world of music means to me. So blah, 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 blah. I just keep on going here. I'm going to go ahead right now and play a song called It's Gonna Work Out Fine. And this is Thoroughbred Carole King. Come on, babe. Carole on piano. Tom Scott. Yeah. Congratulations. Yeah. Can write a hook, you know. It's just great, you know. And just hearing the guys, I mean, I recognize everybody's playing. Boy, they certainly weren't shy about putting the bass up front on that one. Thank you. So here's another one from the album called "Still Here Thinking of You." There's a bunch of great songs on this. There's great songs on every one of Carole's projects. So I mean, if this wets your whistle and you're not totally, you know, aware of what Carole's done, you know, just that's the beauty of YouTube and all these different formats, is you can go just peruse and find all kinds of goodies in there. So this is called "Still Here Thinking of You." Another, just a different energy on this one.
I'm
she knows how to write a song. I mean, if she had only written You've Got a Friend and written Natural Woman with Jerry Goffin, that would be enough career for anybody. But add to that hundreds and hundreds of other songs. She's staggering. She's just really something special. I sit there just thinking back to being over at A&M Studios, sitting in there cutting. Yeah, I think Lou's label at this point was Ode Records, but it was probably part of the A&M family at that time. The A&M lot was such a magical place to be back in the day before it finally was sold, I think, to Universal Music, and then Henson Studios took over. But the beautiful part of it is that they've maintained the studios, that with all the things that changed on the lot, the studios are still intact from those days. And I'm grateful of that, because so many of the greatest studios in this town are long gone and never to return. So it's always a joy. And just being there the other day doing the immediate family, you know, documentary filming there, you know, you just, every time you walk in there, there's this rush of memories that comes over you when you walk into that lot. You know, some things have changed, but there's a lot there that still, you know, is so familiar. And it was like a home away from home. And you'd be out there in the hallways working, and you'd look, and there'd be the Carpenters would be there, Joni Mitchell would be there. I mean, just all these amazing people. Go and hang out with David Anderle or Lou Adler or any of the great producers, hang out with Jerry Moss and Herb Alpert. Because A&M was Alpert and Moss, Herb Alpert and Jerry Moss. It was their studio. So that's how it was called, A&M Studios. So, okay, this is a great song. And all these things, a lot of these we did like on the TRT tour. So it was great. So this is kind of almost a standard at this point. Only Love Is Real. Here we go. As soon as we played this opening line in concert, the audience would go, yeah, yeah. The thing that was great about these sessions was, first off, I love an album that's cohesive, has a producer, has a band, has an artist, rather than so many projects now have all the tracks are cut by different producers, have different rhythm sections on them, so there isn't that cohesive quality that an album like this had. These early albums were really just focused on putting together a team and doing it. And when we got in the studio for these things, I mean, we would at most have a chord chart just to give you a basic outline, but nobody was telling us what songs to, you know, what parts to play or anything like that. I mean, we would talk songs out, and so that during the course of it, if anybody had ideas, we were throwing ideas around like crazy. And certainly if Carole was saying, you know, let's try this, double this part with me or something, we worked on them. It wasn't like completely, you know, just you in your little corner. It was an incredibly collaborative effort on everybody's parts on these. So I'm going to do one more song, and then I'm going to let everybody get on with their days. This one is called High Out of Time. And just makes me smile. You know, I'm actually smiling under here. Working on these songs with Carole was really such a joy. So here we go. She's such a good pianist too. Thank you, Carole. Man, thank you for a wonderful opportunity to be a part of your musical journey. And I'm forever grateful to being involved with artists like Carole. You know, if I only ever played on that record with her, I'd be a happy camper. So so I'm going to let everybody go off. I'm going to head off to go play with the guys I was just listening to. I mean, that's what blows my mind, though. You know, after all these decades that we're all still close friends, still love playing together, and still creating new music. It's not a retro band. It's just all new stuff, new directions, and new adventures. So it's pretty damn cool. Can't complain. So I'm out of here. I'm going to wish everybody a great day. The thing I was going to do today, I'll do tomorrow. It was another project that I did with Russ and Cooch and Waddy and Jeff Pivar and a bunch of real cast of characters and really some fun stuff. So I'll get to that tomorrow. I'm going to head off to see the guys now. And again, I'm going to say thank you so much to everybody out there daily who's just putting it out there to keep us afloat. Try to be as safe and smart as you possibly can, and get your shots. Let's get this over with as best we can. It's never going to go away. Flu's never gone away. None of these things ever go away. That's why they suggest every year you go get a shot, you know, just to boost your immune system, because these things are tenacious. We are their host. And they are really happy to jump into the fray and make us sick. So you do all you can. So just be smart through this. Everybody has to make their own decisions in their lives. But, you know, just try to do something that'll protect the groups. Okay? I'm out of here. I'm going to get running, get on the freeway. And I will talk to you all tomorrow. Okie dokie. Bye-bye.